Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here with you, Madam Rajavi, all of the distinguished guests on the podium and here, and all of you that are here today with us. We're here for a common purpose. Couldn't possibly be a more important common purpose that unites us. And that's the desire for freedom. It's a desire that exists in the human heart, in the human soul, in the human conscience. And no matter the obstacles put in its way, it always prevails. So I want you all to begin and to end today with great hope. With great hope that you're on the right side. And there may be still some more obstacles in our way, maybe even some greater than we've faced before. But we're going to prevail. You are the future of Iran. You can look at each other, see each other. You're the future. They're the past. They're the past. The distant past. The Dark Ages, the Middle Ages, the things they're doing. These are things we haven't seen in the world in 700, 800, 900 years, 1,000 years. So you're the future, and it's our job. Madam Rajavi, her whole movement, the people you see here, the so many others that we have, as you know, Madam Rajavi, on our side in America. Republicans and Democrats and liberals and conservatives and who knows what else, libertarians and maybe even some kooks. Who knows what we have? But we've got a lot of people united in one single mission. We understand that it is better for the world, now critical for the world, that it be a free, independent, democratic, non-nuclear Iran. That's why we're here. Make no mistake about it. In my country, over the last couple of weeks, there's been a very deep discussion after some of the terrible bombings and attacks and beheadings and burnings that we've seen. There's been a deep discussion of where's the alternative ideology within Islam to confront this barbarism, whether it's the barbarism of ISIS or the barbarism of the mullahs. Both equal, hard to say which is worse. Mullahs have been doing it for much longer, actually. And the mullahs are much more organized. Remember, there is no one that disputes, no one that disputes that the Iranian regime is the single biggest sponsor of terrorism in the world. The single biggest state sponsor of terrorism in the world. Whether it's in Syria or Iraq or Yemen or in many other places, there is no other country that sponsors terrorism to the extent of Iran. So we begin with the following premise. If that is the case, how can we trust them? We have to approach them with tremendous questioning and tremendous care. And we're looking for this alternative ideology. I'm asked it all the time. Where's the alternative ideology to this extremism that we see? The Shia extremism, the Sunni extremism, the extremism in Iran, the extremism in Iraq and Syria and Yemen. Where's the alternative to it? And what is the alternative to it? You're the alternative to it. You are. You're the alternative. You're what they're all looking for. Will you please come and find us? We're here. Don't need to be searching all over. been here for decades. We don't need to invent it. What do you stand for? What do you stand for? You stand for a government in which people are elected. You stand for a government that has a rule of law. You stand for a government that is secular in the sense that everyone's religion is respected. You stand for a government that gives women equal rights with men, and you have a woman who is your leader. You stand like we all do for the value of human life, every human life. The ones we see burned and beheaded. Those lives are valuable human lives. The pictures we see as we walk in, who knows what they could have accomplished? Patrick Kennedy or Alan Dershowitz, I don't remember which one, said to me, imagine if these people had lived. What could they have accomplished? Imagine if the people who were killed during the Holocaust, imagine if they had lived. Maybe we would have a cure for cancer now. Maybe our society would be beyond much of this because we lost so much. We lost, seems to be, lose our best people. Isn't that true, Madam Rajavi? When they kill and when they destroy and when they go into Ashraf as they did to kill our people, I consider them now, as all of us do up here, our people. When they came there and killed our people, they took some of our best people. They don't do this by accident. They do it by design. Well, you stand for all the things that we're looking for as this alternative to Islamic extremist terrorism. And you also stand for a non-nuclear Iran, which is so important to the safety of the region and the safety of the world. So stop looking. Here it is. Here's the movement around which you can build the future of Iran and the model of how you can integrate tremendous religious beliefs with a government that allows people to believe what they want to believe. You can do it, and you can show them how to do it. So we have shared goals, and that brings us together. And I will tell you this. Number one, never lose hope. That's what sustains us. Number two, never ever believe you won't prevail. Those who have stuck to the notion that freedom must be restored have always won. And third, it's for all of us to do a better job, all of us, me, all of the people you see on this panel, and all of you, to do a better job of getting this message out to the whole world. Because this is the message the world needs right now. The world needs to know that within the Islamic religion, within Iran, the majority of people, I am sure, if not the vast majority of people, want what you want. But they're not allowed to have it or to get it because they are being oppressed. What do I mean by oppressed? I mean jailed. I mean tortured. I mean beheaded. I mean executed. These things can't be allowed in the modern world. So let's focus for a moment on one thing I don't want to forget before I finish, and that is liberty and Ashraf. As we ponder these very big issues of the alternative to extremist fundamentalist Islam, as we ponder and deal with this nuclear agreement that could be exceedingly dangerous to the world, let's not forget we have left people behind. There's a there's a core value of our military, which is we should leave no one behind. And we have left some behind because the United Nations, and I say this with the deepest regret, my country has broken their promise to them. Every one of these people who has been murdered has a piece of paper signed by the United States of America guaranteeing them protection. That is a sacred promise. We can disagree as Americans about everything because we're a democracy, but we cannot disagree about our honor as a country. That must be redeemed. Those people should have been removed 2 years ago, 3 years ago, with American airplanes taken to America. We signed the promise, not Albania, not Italy, not France, not Germany, not Japan. It was signed by the United States of America, a country that supposedly values liberty above all else, and a country that is a country of honor. And I am personally disgraced by the inability of my government to live up to its word. There should be no question about it, no diplomacy about it. No other Iranian issue should stand in the way of the United States of America keeping its word and preventing these people from being murdered. Now, briefly, let's look at the agreement. This agreement on nuclear weapons in Iran. As Secretary of State, former Secretary of State Shultzen, former Secretary of State Kissinger made clear before the United States Congress last week, the whole purpose for the last 10 years has been to keep nuclear capacity out of the hands of maniacs. Because that is who controls Iran, maniacs, people who are constantly talking about the destruction of the state of Israel. Iran was much worse than anything that happened in Egypt or Libya, or anything that has happened where we have supported the people that have overthrown the government. The basis of this negotiation has always been, until it was shifted in the interim agreement, no nuclear capacity for Iran. Now, why is that so? First of all, Iran does not need nuclear reactors. Iran does not need the peaceful use of nuclear power. Iran has plenty of power. This would be like Saudi Arabia saying, we need, you know, nuclear power for peaceful uses. Saudi Arabia has more oil, more natural resources. There's no possible peaceful reason for this. You have to be stupid to think that that is so. I'm going to say it again. You have to be stupid, dumb, ignorant, immature, and foolish to think that Iran wants this for peaceful purposes. They don't have enough energy in Iran. Well, we know why they want it. They want it so they can be a nuclear power, so they can assert themselves, so they can do what they've been doing, which is taking over Iraq, taking over Syria. See how far they can go. See how big their kingdom can become. See how big their empire can become. This is why they want it. And this is why at the core of whatever we agree to, if we do agree, then Iran has to give up any form of nuclear power. No, we shouldn't be measuring the amount of enrichment. You know why? There should be nothing to enrich. And if we do, we get to a second level of stupidity. The second level of stupidity is to think that we can trust them. Oh, they can have 15% or 20% enrichment or 30% or 40%. But we can inspect. We can go looking around Iran and keep them there. And my mother, and I'm sure many of your mothers and fathers have always said that everyone can make a mistake. But anyone who makes a mistake twice is a moron. Well, we made this mistake once before. And they promised they weren't going to enrich. And it is your organization that revealed them twice. Not once, twice. For their lies. Rouhani has bragged about how he fooled us in doing this. So how can we possibly be negotiating with them for any kind of nuclear capacity and have any sense that they're going to be any more honest now than they were then? So the core of this agreement has to be no nuclear capacity for Iran. And an Iran that promises in the agreement to cease supporting terrorist groups in Iraq and in Syria and in Yemen and in other parts of the world. That should be linked to this agreement. And finally, if there is such an agreement, it should be presented to the United States Congress for ratification. This should not become the act, the unilateral act of just one man. That is not America. That is not what our founders envisioned for a substantial, enormously important agreement. This is a treaty, and it is subject to ratification. This should not be done by the act of freedom, peace, and security of the world. This should be presented to Congress for ratification so the American people, not just one man, with one singular purpose, gets the chance to do this. This should be the act of the American people, not just one man. And finally, if we ever should reach that day of that agreement and the Congress ratifying, nothing in that agreement should give up our goal. Nothing in that agreement should give up our hope. Nothing in that agreement should compromise our faith that there will be regime change in Tehran. Finally, we have to see the connection between the different forms, so-called different forms, of Islamic extremist terrorism. And we have to be smart enough to understand that as we try to wipe out ISIS and Al-Qaeda to the extent that it still exists, that we don't do it just to make Iran more powerful, stronger, have greater hegemony. Well, Iran is just as dangerous as ISIS. Honestly, I believe Iran is more dangerous than ISIS. We don't need Iran to wipe out ISIS. The United States of America is still, without any doubt, whether the president likes this or not, still the greatest military power in the history of the world. I'm not sure if you combined all of the military capacity of most countries in the world, you'd even equal ours. We have the capacity to wipe out ISIS. And what we should say to the mullahs and the ayatollahs and the crooks and murderers and bums who run Iran, we don't want you as part of our coalition. We want Jordan. We want Saudi Arabia. We want Qatar. We want the Arab countries that want to join us in this effort. But we don't want murderers and assassins on our side. And my goodness, if we had the will, Iran is irrelevant to our ability to wipe out ISIS, given the capacity that the United States of America has. And if we could only understand that by allowing them to do this, we are empowering them. We are giving them Iraq. We are giving them Syria. Are we crazy? Is there something wrong with us? Have we lost the capacity to think? Have we lost the capacity to read history? I am so frustrated. I hope you feel it, because it's there. And let me take the liberty for one moment as a former almost seminarian, and therefore someone who spent a great deal of his life studying theology, including your religion. There is no reason why the Muslim or Islamic religion cannot be made consistent with the modern world. There's absolutely no reason for it. And to a religion that is perfectly consistent with the principles of democracy, freedom for women, freedom for all, and the ability for people to have a life in which they are free of oppression. It can happen. Not only that, it will happen. Ultimately, here's what our job is. All of us, however or wherever we operate, here's our job. Ultimately, that's the way Iran is going to be. And whenever that day is, you're going to be looked upon as heroes. But I want that ultimately to be now. I want that ultimately to be as soon as possible. I want that ultimately to happen as quickly as we can make it happen. You know why? Because fewer people will die, fewer people will be slaughtered, fewer lives will be taken. And if we can have an Iran that shows the way to a modern state where the majority population is Muslim, but they respect greatly the values of all other religions and people. If we can create an Iran like that, we can create a Middle East like that. And then ultimately we can create a world like that, and we can have peace. That's your goal. Don't give up hope, no matter what happens, no matter how many attacks, no matter how many killings. Remember the words of Churchill, my hero, or one of them, when he looked Hitler in the face and said, if you want to take England, you can, but you're going to have to come into every home, you're going to have to come into every house, you're going to have to kill us, and you're going to have to kill every single one of them, one of us, and if there's one Englishman alive, he will fight you and try to stop you. We will not let them prevail. Keep up the hope. Don't let anything stop it. The worse they get, the stronger we get, and we are going to prevail. And to the people of liberty, we have not forgotten you. We will never forget you. Thank you.